Hello. Now you are aware about electronic configuration, especially SPDF level electronic configuration. On basis of that, we are starting out a chapter that is very, very important. This is considered in inorganic chemistry, but very useful for organic chemistry also. The name of chapter is chemical bonding. So let us start the chapter chemical bonding. What is the meaning of chemical bond? Say for example, one atom is here and one atom is here. Can we say that there is chemical bond between these two atoms? Answer is obviously no. In order to get chemical bond, these two atoms must be so close to each other that there should be overlapping of their orbital. Now these views are modern view. In old days, they were considered different aspects. The first aspect that is called as electronic theory of valence. On basis of that, the rule is there. That rule is called as octet rule. Octet means 8 number. Octet rule states that every element try to complete 8 electron in last shell, either by donating or by accepting or by sharing out electron. Now, this rule is modified because helium-like atoms are there. They are not able to finish out their octet. So, we have to finish out their duplet. That means 2 electrons in last shell. And so, this rule is modified. I am revising this rule again. According to octet rule, every element tries to finish or tries to attain nearest inert gas configuration. This rule is called as octet rule. In what way it tries to complete nearest inert gas configuration? Either by accepting or by donating or by sharing out electron. Now, let us discuss on basis of this octet rule certain theories. The first type of bond according to octet rule, that bond is called as ionic bond. The technical name is electrovalent bond, but simply we are calling it as ionic bond. So let us discuss. Now let us discuss electronic theory of valency. On basis of that, different types of bond we have to discuss. The first bond we are going to study, that is called as ionic bond. The technical name is electrovalent bond. Let us discuss this electrovalent bond. For that purpose, we are considering two different atoms. The first atom, that is sodium, atomic number 11. The electronic configuration is 2, 8, 1. The second atom we have to consider, that is chlorine, atomic number is 17. That means 17 electrons are there. Please keep in mind, atomic number means number of protons present in any atom. But in atom, number of proton is exactly equal to number of electron. Therefore, we are considering 11 electrons are there. So, electronic configuration is 2, 8, 1. Here, electronic configuration is 2, 8, 7. Now, what octet rule states? I have to revise again. According to octet rule, every element tries to complete or tries to attain nearest inert gas configuration by accepting, donating or sharing out of electron. Now, here, the nearest inert gas for sodium, that should be neon, atomic number 10. Whereas for chlorine, the nearest inert gas is argon, atomic number is 18. So 17, 18, 11 and 10. So quite close to each other. Electronic configuration is 2, 8. Whereas here, electronic configuration is 2, 8, 8. That means, in order to attain configuration of neon, sodium is having extra electron. Whereas, in order to attain configuration of argon, chlorine is having one electron short. Now, simple thing that sodium donates electron and chlorine accepts electron. Then only sodium can attain electronic configuration of neon and chlorine can attain electronic configuration of argon. Now, what is the problem? There are 11 protons in sodium. You are aware one proton carries plus one charge. So 11 proton will carry 11 plus 11 charge. In earlier atom, the sodium, it is having 11 electrons. So one electron is having minus 1 charge, 11 electrons will have minus 11 charge. The net charge, that is plus 11 and minus 11, is 0. That means sodium atom is electrically neutral. But now see in next part. In any atom, number of protons should remain same. The constant number, that is only number of protons. So 11 protons are as it is in sodium. But one electron is donated by sodium to chlorine. What is the result of that? Number of electrons 2, 8. So that is 10. So this will be minus 10. If you add out, you are getting charge as plus 1. Now by our definition, atom should not have any charge. But here, you are able to observe practically, atom is having charge. The charged atom is called as an ion. So henceforth, I have to say, this is sodium ion, whereas this is sodium atom. What is the difference between atom and ion? Atom is not having any charge, whereas ion is having charge, either positive or negative, but charge must be there. This way, sodium attains plus 1 charge. Now let us talk of chlorine. There are 17 protons in chlorine. What is the result of that? Plus 17 charge. Same way, 17 electrons addition will get 0. So this is chlorine atom. Now, after accepting electron, chlorine is having 2, 8, 8 configuration. That means net 18 electrons are there. So minus charge or negative charge is now become minus 18. The result, net charge, that means addition, you are getting here minus 1. So you are aware, we are not able to call this as an atom, so we have to call this as an ion. So consequence is that two ions are produced. So when sodium and chlorine, they are interacting each other, sodium donates electron to chlorine, chlorine accepts electron from sodium, sodium get developed positive charge as plus 1, chlorine get developed negative charge as minus 1. Now this is sodium atom having plus 1 charge and chlorine atom having minus 1 charge. Am I right? No. This is sodium ion and this is chloride ion. Now this is minus charge and this is plus charge. What is the result of that? There is attraction between unlike charges, and this attraction is called as electromagnetic attraction or electrostatic attraction between these two ions, these two charged particles, and therefore we are calling this attractive force as ionic bond or electrovalent bond. So sodium get developed into positively charged ion, chlorine get developed into negatively charged ion, and what is the result of that? They are having positive negative, that means opposite charges. The result is that there is attraction between opposite charges and we are having the bond formation. This is called as ionic bond. Oppositely charged ions are bound together, so that this is called as ionic charge. So this is one example of ionic charge. You can same way trace out another example also, that potassium having atomic number 19 and fluorine having atomic number 9. You can go by the same method and you will try yourself that what is the result of that, in what way bond is formed. This is about practical transfer of electron from one atom to another atom. The bond is called as electrovalent bond. Now, every time situation is not so. Let us take example of oxygen atom. We are denoting oxygen atom as O2. Actually, we should call it as molecule. Instead of oxygen atom, we are now calling as molecule. This is called as diatomic molecule. Now, this oxygen is having atomic number 8. The electronic configuration is 2, 6. Now, the nearest inert gas that should be again neon, atomic number 10, electronic configuration 2, 8. You can observe here 6 electron and 8 electron, that means oxygen is having 2 electrons short. But suppose another donor atom is not available, then what it can do? There is the chance, I am showing in this way, this is oxygen nucleus which is carrying out 8 protons. This is first orbital of oxygen which is having 2 electrons. This is second orbital of oxygen. Now there is overlap of another oxygen orbital over here. This is nucleus of another oxygen, this is first orbital of another oxygen having 2 electrons. Now there are totally 6 electrons here and here. So I am writing this way, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. The 2 electrons are on border. Here also 2 electrons are here. That means you can observe at one incident, this oxygen is having 8 electrons, whereas this oxygen is having only 4 electrons. But another incident, you can observe that this oxygen is having 8 electrons, this oxygen is having 4 electrons. So, one electron, that is total 2 electrons from this atom and 2 electrons from this atom, they get shared over here. So, this is called as sharing up of electrons. Sharing up of electron will give a type of bond that is called as covalent bond. So whenever sharing up of electron is carried out, there is no problem of charged atom or say ion formation. Atom remains electrically neutral as it is, but it is in bonding condition and electrons are shared out. So this is called as covalent bond. The number of electrons shared give rise to number of bonds formed. Say for example, one pair of electrons is shared, that means one bond is formed. If two pair of electrons, let us discuss here, hydrogen. Hydrogen is having atomic number 1, that means it's having one electron only. So instead of this, we can go here, first orbit only, and this is one electron here and one electron here. So, nearest inner gas is helium, having atomic number 2. Electronic configuration is also 2. So, just find out here, 2 electrons are there. One from this hydrogen, one from this hydrogen. So, at one incident, duplet is complete for one hydrogen. At another incident, duplet is complete for another hydrogen. So, this way, these hydrogens are sharing out one electron each. So, net number of electrons shared, 2. So bond formed between hydrogen and hydrogen, we have to say only one bond is formed between hydrogen and hydrogen. But in case of oxygen, there is formation of double bond between two oxygen, because two electrons from one and two electrons from another get shared. Now same way, try to find out nitrogen, atomic number 7. And no doubt, after this lecture you have to give test. In that test, this question is asked, how many number of bonds are formed between nitrogen and nitrogen? No doubt, nitrogen is also giving covalent bond. So this is about electrovalent bond and covalent bond. The third type of bond, that is called as coordinate bond. But we are not discussing coordinate bond over here. Whenever we are discussing about D block element and F block element, at that time we have to discuss about coordinate bond in detail. So I have to study and I have to teach coordinate bond as separate part. And so I am not giving details of coordinate bond over here. So according to this electronic theory of valency, there are totally 3 types of bond. One is called as electrovalent, another is called as covalent, and third is called as coordinate. Out of that, we have discussed electrovalent bond and covalent bond. Coordinate bond we are keeping outside. We'll discuss when we are discussing D block element, F block element, coordinate compounds. We have to discuss it separately. I hope you are able to discuss and you are able to draw the structure for nitrogen. Now, on basis of this, let us find out how to draw a dash structure and dot structure. I have to go for hydrogen again. Hydrogen was having one electron. Another hydrogen is having one electron. We are quite sure from atomic structure that electrons are identical one. We are not able to distinguish two electrons with respect to mass, with respect to charge, with respect to any other thing. But here we are just simplifying. This dot means electron of this hydrogen and this means electron of this hydrogen. So this way we are simplifying. So this is called as dot structure. Whereas hydrogen form one bond with another hydrogen, this is called as dash structure. Same way about oxygen. Two electrons are involved from one oxygen, two electrons are involved from another oxygen. So there is dash structure like this, whereas dot structure like this. Now you are aware, in case of nitrogen, there are 5 electrons in last shell. 3 electrons are engaged in bonding. So these 3 electrons are from this, whereas I have to show this as lone pair of electron. Can you give me simple answer? How pair can be lone? What is the meaning of lone pair? That pair belong to same atom. Then that is called as lone pair of electron. Now here, I have to show lone pair as this. Here also lone pair of electron is there. So this is dot structure. Another nitrogen, 3 electrons are there, whereas this lone pair, now bond is formed. So 3 bonds are formed between nitrogen and nitrogen. Say at one incident you will get 3 plus 3, 6 plus 2, 8 electron. In another part you will get 3 plus 3, 6 plus 2, 8 electron. This is dot structure. Whereas in case of dash structure, no need to show lone pair of electron directly. The bonding condition only we have to say. So nitrogen and nitrogen, triple bond is there between two nitrogen atoms. So this is about the representation. Now same way we can represent H2O. How you are going to represent H2O? Hydrogen is having one electron. Oxygen is having total 6 electron. Out of that, one is paired with this hydrogen and one is paired with another hydrogen. So total 2 bonds are formed from oxygen, whereas one bond each is formed by hydrogen. So this is dot structure of water molecule, whereas dash structure I can draw this. Anyway, conditions are maintained. Here hydrogen is having 2 electrons, hydrogen is having 2 electrons, whereas oxygen is having 8 electrons around it. So this is the octet rule and theory of electronic theory of valency. On basis of that we have discussed. But you are aware, in case of religious matter and in case of science, there is something different. In science, nobody is 100% correct. In case of science, we can cross-examine. But in religion or religious matter, whatever is given in that book, only we have to obey that. That is the difference between science and religion. Here, after giving this theory, we are having lot of things that we can able to contradict. This is called as limitations or inadequacies of octet rule. Certain examples are there. Let us take well-known example of PCl5, phosphorus pentachloride. From school days only you are aware of this compound. This is the existing compound. You are aware phosphorus is having atomic number 15, whereas chlorine is having atomic number 17. I have to give electronic configuration of phosphorus 2, 8,
1. Whereas for chlorine, it is 2, 8, 7. The central atom is of phosphorus. I am drawing structure over here. So phosphorus is central atom. I should not consider 2 and 8. And now last orbital only considering 5 electrons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These 5 electrons are of phosphorus, outermost shell, chlorine. I have to consider only last shell. 6 electron, whereas 1 is entered in bonding. Same way here also, 1 is entered in bonding. 1, 1 and 1. I am not shown here purposefully. Now here, look. 8 electrons are there around chlorine. Whereas here, just you can count 5 electrons of phosphorus and 5 electrons of chlorine. So net number of electrons around phosphorus is, calculate, 10. What octet rule states, every element tries to complete 8 electrons in last shell or nearest inert gas configuration. Now here, nearest inert gas configuration for phosphorus is obviously of neon. But in practice, it is exceeding that electronic configuration and attaining something different, that is the configuration of magnesium. Something strange. 10 electrons are there. So this condition is called as expanded octet. There is only one example. No, so many examples are there. You are aware of this compound, SF6, sulfur hexafluoride. When we are carrying out vulcanization of rubber, this sulfur hexafluoride is used. So here sulfur hexafluoride atomic number is 16, whereas this atomic number is 9. Now you can do this yourself. Now pause this video and draw this type of diagram for sulfur hexafluoride. Pause this video for, I hope you must have drawn the structure of SF6. I am writing again. Sulfur, that is the central atom. You are aware atomic number of sulfur is 16. So electronic configuration is 2, 8, 6. Whereas fluorine atomic number is 9. So electronic configuration is 2, 7. Now sulfur outermost shell is having 6 electrons. So I am writing out 6 electrons here. Whereas fluorine, one lone pair, second lone pair, third lone pair. And one electron is in shell. Electronic configuration is 2, 7. Now, same way here, another fluorine, total half dozen fluorine atoms are involved. Now look at this incident. 8 electrons are complete around fluorine. So octet rule is obeyed. But look here. In this circle of sulfur, there are total 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. 12 number of electrons are there around sulfur. And still, we are saying this is according to octet rule. Sulfur hexafluoride is very stable compound. This is not imaginary or hypothetical compound. Practically observed compound. And therefore, we have to say this is limitation of octet rule. This is called as expanded octet condition. Expanded octet means more than 8 number of electrons are observed and still compound is practically stable compound. Now same way, another case is there. You can check out for beryllium chloride. Atomic number of beryllium is 4. Don't confuse with barium. This is Ba, whereas this is Be. Atomic number is 4. And you are aware of atomic number of fluorine, that is 17. Pause this video and try to find out electronic configuration and this dot structure of beryllium chloride. Beryllium, atomic number 4. So electronic configuration 2-2. So 2 electrons are there in last shell, whereas chlorine, you are aware now 7 electrons are there. So 1 pair, 2 pair, 3rd pair, and 1 is in share. Same way here also 1 pair is in share. Sorry, 1 electron is in share. just observe here, 8 electrons are on chlorine. So octet is completed for chlorine. But observe here, around beryllium, there are totally 4 electrons. Now actually, these electron number should be 8 or 2, but it is 4. And technically speaking, this should be 8, but this is 4. And so, this is called as incomplete octet. Another example, you can try yourself, boron trifluoride or simply BF3. You are aware of atomic number of boron 5 and fluorine 7. Try this example along with me. Boron is having atomic number 5, so electronic configuration is 2-3. That means boron is having 3 electrons in outermost shell, whereas fluorine, you are aware, 7 electrons are in outermost shell, so 3 lone pairs and 1 is unpaired electron. So for fluorine, octet is completed, but for boron, you will find there are only 6 electrons around boron, and so octet is not completed. So this is another example of incomplete octet. So this way, octet rule is not able to explain this type of situation where either less number of electrons are observed or more number of electrons are observed than 8. And so this is called as incomplete octet or expanded octet. This is the first inadequacy or limitation of octet rule. Now second limitation of octet rule that we have discussed these all things, but we are not able to justify what is the shape of molecule. We have discussed dash structure of water. At that time, we are writing out water like this, HOH. That means, here we can write down bond angle as 180 degree. Is it perfect or not? We don't know. The practically observed bond angle is like this. This is 104 degree and 29 minutes. Or simply we can say approximately 104.5 degree. So this is the observed bond angle. Whereas on basis of this electronic theory of valency, we are not able to predict of this bond angle. So this is another limitation or another inadequacy of octet rule, that we are not able to find out the structure of molecule. Third limitation, that we are not able to find out the energy statistics on formation of molecule, whether energy of that molecule is getting lower or higher. We are not concerned anything about energy of molecule. We are not concerned about nature of interacting forces. These are the drawbacks of octet rule, limitations of octet rule or inadequacies of octet rule. I am revising expanded octet or incomplete octet. Then geometry, that means shape of molecule, energy structure of molecule, then nature of interacting forces. These concepts are not explained on basis of this octet rule. And so we have to state for new theory, that is valence bond. Now, you are aware about electronic theory of valence. No doubt, we have discussed some drawbacks or limitations of that theory. But still, in earlier days, this theory proves more effective. Now, on basis of that, another theory is put forward in order to explain the nature of bond. This theory is called as valence bond theory. I am revising the name, valence bond theory, or simply we can remember VBT. Now, according to this theory, certain postulate means something we have to assume, that is assumptions or postulates that we have to discuss here. The first thing, that bond is formed only and only when there is overlap of orbital. One atom is in India and another is in Pakistan, and we are saying that there is formation of bond. No possibility. That cannot happen in case of molecule. So in case of formation of molecule, or in case of formation of bond, the first and important thing, that the bonding
atoms should have overlapping of orbit. Now, second condition, this is still more important, that overlapping orbital should have one unpaired electron in each orbit. So, the number of bonds formed equal to number of unpaired electrons present in that atom. I am revising again. According to the postulate of VBT, the bonding orbital should have unpaired electron. If one atom is having paired electrons and another atom is not having any electron, then bond is not possible. According to VBT, both the orbitals should have unpaired electron, and these orbitals should be of comparable energy. Now, comparable energy is something difficult word to understand. Comparable means energy should be of comparable level. One orbital of first, one atom is having orbital of first shell and another atom is in seventh shell. So this type of energies are not comparable. But first shell and second shell and third shell, they are of comparable energy levels. Now, the another postulate that we have to discuss something in detail, that whenever bond is formed, in case of formation of bond, electron density, go to atomic structure chapter, there we are finding out that electron finding probability. This term we are using here as electron density. Electron density means number of time electron is coming in that particular area. The number of time is more, that means electron density is more. Whenever bond formation is there, electron density between two nuclei should be more. Then this situation is called as bonding situation. Let us discuss this point in detail now. This is one atom, this is another atom, this is nucleus of one atom, this is nucleus of another, this is the electron. By discussing the inadequacies of electronic theory of valency, this point was there, that nature of interacting forces is not clear. Now here, between nucleus of one atom and nucleus of another atom, both are having same charge. That means there is repulsion. Nucleus of this atom and electron of this atom, opposite charge, therefore there is attraction. Nucleus of this atom and electron of this atom, there is opposite charge, so attraction. Same way, nucleus of this atom and electron of this atom, attraction. Electron of this atom and electron of this atom, same charge, therefore repulsion. But what is VBT postulate? They should have unpaired electrons. When unpaired electrons are there, they are having opposite spins. Opposite spin will produce magnetic field in different directions. So electrically they can repel, and magnetically somewhat attraction is also there. No doubt it is very less, but still it is there. And therefore, somewhat attraction and somewhat repulsion. Why repulsion? Because of same charge. Why attraction? Because of opposite spin. Opposite magnetic fields are produced, and therefore somewhat attraction. That means there is minimization of repulsion between electron and electron if electrons are unpaired and they are of opposite spin. So this is called as nature of interacting forces. Suppose electrons spend more time over here, this electron also spend more time over here, then the nuclei are not exposed to each other. What will the result? There is development of attractive force and minimization of repulsive energy or potential energy. Bonding condition is always having minimization of energy. Now this minimization of energy we can explain on basis of formation of hydrogen molecule. This is potential energy curve diagram. This is graphical representation. Let us imagine that two hydrogen atoms are at infinite distance. Infinite distance means they are so away from each other that there is no interaction between these two. I am revising the word hydrogen atoms, not hydrogen molecule. Hydrogen atom means this is H and this is H. They are at infinite distance. There is no interaction. So potential energy is zero. This is our x-axis. This point lies over here where there is no interaction. The moment these two atoms are close enough and interaction starts, there are, here I am explaining, this is electron and this is electron. This is clockwise spin, this is anti-clockwise spin. One electrons are there and they will try to arrange themselves in between two nuclei. The result is that you will find that henceforth there is continuous decrease in potential energy till there is perfect overlap between hydrogen and hydrogen. This is minimization of energy. This is higher the potential energy, lower energy, and this is zero condition. But then onwards, suddenly we'll get shoot up. If distance decreases further, on this axis, we are taking interatomic distance, or rather internuclear distance, and this is potential energy. So on y-axis, we are considering potential energy. On x-axis, we are considering distance between two nuclei. The distance between two nuclei decreases. We are getting sudden shoot up in the energy. Reason is the simple here. This is one nucleus, this is another nucleus. When overlapping is there, these nuclei are coming close to each other. Till certain level they can bear, but after that they are exposed to each other. Electrons are arranging themselves in opposite direction. Nuclei are exposed to each other. Nucleus repulsive force become dominant. What is the result of that? We are getting sudden high shoot up in the energy. This is called as potential energy curve. This is the bonding condition. And this distance between two nuclei, whenever minimum potential energy is there, that distance is called as bond length. So now you are aware of new term, bond length. What is bond length? Distance between two nuclei in perfect bonding condition. That distance is called as bond length. Now, we can keep in mind that molecules are in continuous vibration, and therefore bond length is not a fixed distance, but we have to take mean distance, so that is called as bond length. Now this is the perfect thing, that we can able to determine bond length, we can able to discuss the energy nature, then nature of interacting forces, all is there in this VBT. But still certain concepts are remain unanswered over here. Say for example, what VBT, the important postulate gives, that is, whenever bond formation is there, only unpaired electron is paired up with another atom. Number of bond form is directly proportional to number of unpaired electrons. Suppose hydrogen, now suppose there is hydrogen, one electron is there. Unpaired electron, one means unpaired, so it is giving one bond. Same way, carbon, let us discuss now. Carbon atomic number is 6. Now I don't want this lower level configuration. Try to recollect whatever we have discussed in atomic structure. So electronic configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p2. But you are aware, when p orbital is last, we have to split up like this. This is 2px, 2py, and 2pz. One electron enters here, one electron enters here. This is according to Hertz rule of maximum multiplicity. Electron tries to remain unpaired as far as possible. So, number of unpaired electron in carbon atom, 2. So, carbon should be divalent and carbon should give compound like CH2. But in practice, we are aware that carbon is giving compound CH4, and carbon is not divalent, carbon is tetravalent, tetra means 4. So carbon is forming 4 bonds, but according to VBT, it should form only 2 bonds. Same way, again you are aware of this compound, boron, and you are aware of the compound which is existing, this is BF3. Configuration 1s2, 2s2, 2p1. As it is 2p1, electronic configuration should be 2px1. So I am writing directly here 2px1, but I should not keep this vacant. So 2py0 and 2pz0. Now, number of unpaired electron 1. So boron should be monovalent and it should give compound BF. But in practice, it is found that it is giving BF3. Same way, you are aware of this compound now, BCl2. Beryllium is having atomic number 4. So electronic configuration 1s2, 2s2. All electrons are paired. There is no unpaired electron. As a result, beryllium should not give any compound. Beryllium must be inert element. But in practice, we are able to observe BCl2. The compound is there. That means something problematic is there in this valence bond theory. We have to throw this theory away. Answer is that no. We have to modify this theory. This modification is called as hybridization. This is the concept of hybridization we have to introduce. Now, why concept of hybridization is required? In order to explain tetravalency of carbon, trivalency of boron, and divalency of beryllium, we have to introduce the concept of hybridization over here. Okay. Now, we are there on the question, why carbon is tetravalent instead of divalent? Why boron is trivalent instead of monovalent? And why beryllium is divalent instead of inert? Let us start this. For that, we have to introduce a concept of hybridization. We have discussed that this divalency, trivalency, tetravalency, that is not explained on basis of BBT. Same way, certain bond angles, they are also not explained on basis of BBT. Like water, the practically found bond angle of water is 104.5, whereas according to BBT, the bond angle should be 90. Let us discuss this point. But before that, we have to discuss some overlaps. When bond is possible, what are the overlaps possible that we have to discuss? Now, first type of overlap, that is called as SS overlap. This is coordinate system. Here we are discussing S orbital. The electron density is equally distributed along with 3 axis. Whereas another S orbital overlaps. This is called as SS overlap. What is the practical example of this? This is the formation of water molecule. There is one hydrogen and another hydrogen. So hydrogen-hydrogen bond. Because configuration of hydrogen is 1s1, configuration of this hydrogen obviously 1s1. So bond between S and S. Therefore this is called as SS overlap. Another overlap possible, that is PP overlap. What is P and P overlap? So suppose this is one P orbital. Remember we have discussed the P orbital is dumbbell shape. That is directed along with X axis. Then we are calling it as PX orbital. If it is directed along Y axis, we are calling it as PY. And if it is directed along Z axis, then we are calling it as PZ orbital. So here we are overlapping P orbital with another P. This is called as PP overlap. But certain changes we have to make over here. Because whenever bonding takes place, now you are aware that electron density between two nuclei increases. We are aware that When bonding takes place, electron density between two nuclei increases, and therefore this p orbital develop electron density more in this direction where bonding is possible. So here I have shown that both the lobes are of equal size, but the lobes are of unequal size. This is minor lobe and this is major part of lobe. Same way here. So this type of overlap is there. Now if overlap is along x-axis, we have to say px, px overlap. If overlap is along y-axis, we have to say py, py overlap, and so on. So here, second overlap we have discussed, that is pp overlap. Example, you can take any halogen. Halogen means fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. So out of that, we can discuss fluorine is having electronic configuration 1s2, 2s2, 2px2, 2py2, 2pz1. So this p orbital of one fluorine overlap with another p orbital of fluorine, and therefore we are getting this type of overlap, that is pp overlap. So this is about ss overlap and pp overlap. Now third type, that is between s and p. Yes, this is also possible. So this is s orbital. Now s orbital characteristic is that electronic density is distributed all over in equal. So there is no formation of lobe. And this is p orbital overlapping with it. This is major lobe and this is minor lobe, but this is having same electron density. So this is called as sp overlap. Example, formation of HCl or formation of HF molecule. This is because hydrogen we have discussed S and fluorine we have discussed it is P. So sp overlap, we can give example of this type. So these are the overlaps. Now let us discuss formation of water molecule. Oxygen, atomic number 8, electronic configuration 1s2, 2s2, 2p. Try to write down yourself first. Pause this video, try to write down yourself. If you are not able to write, then again observe that 2px2, 2py1, 2pz1. So 2py and 2pz, these two orbitals are available, they are having single electron. Now I have arranged accordingly. So let us name this axis as y axis, this as z, and this is our now x axis in order to simplify. This is py orbital, this is pz orbital, this is behind. What is the angle between y and z? 90 degrees. Now s orbital of one hydrogen is overlapping over here, and s orbital of one hydrogen is overlapping over here. That means the bond formation is carried out like this, and therefore the expected bond angle, that is bond angle between z axis and y axis, the bond angle should be 90. Now this 90 degree bond angle is not observed in water. Practically speaking, we are having bond angle as 104 degree and 29 minutes. Or in simple language, we can say it is around 104.5 degree. Now here, question arises. According to our knowledge, the bond angle should be 90, but in practical life, we are getting bond angle as 104.5. Same way, the case is there for ammonia. Are you aware? I mean, ammonia formula, check out NH3. You are aware nitrogen is having atomic number 7. Try to write down electronic configuration yourself of nitrogen. Three hydrogens are overlapping. Just try to write down, pause this video till here, try to write down and find out what is the expected bond angle for ammonia. Bond angle is measured between one point, central point and another point. This here for ammonia, it should be from hydrogen, hydrogen and hydrogen. So this should be the bond angle, or this should be bond angle. So try to find out what is the expected bond angle in ammonia. I hope you are able to write down the electronic configuration of nitrogen, 1s2, 2s2, 2px1, 2py1, 2pz1. If you are not able to follow, just observe here, make 3 boxes, 3 electrons here to fill in P. So first, second and third. Try to remember, according to Hund's rule of maximum multiplicity, we have discussed electron tries to remain unpaired as far as possible. Now, we have to just modify this diagram, because we have to introduce pz or say px orbital here, and there is overlap between another hydrogen. You are aware hydrogen is having electronic configuration 1s1, and therefore every time we have to take s orbital of hydrogen here. So the expected bond angle for nitrogen is 90 degree, because what is the angle between x and z? 90. Z and y, 90. Y and X, 90. So anyway, the bond angle between nitrogen and hydrogen should be 90 degree. But practically speaking, we are having this bond angle as 107 degree. Why? We don't have answer with VBT, and therefore we have to introduce a concept of hybridization. In short, I am revising. Why we have to introduce concept of hybridization? Reason number one, that tetravalency of carbon is not explained, trivalency of boron is also not explained, and divalency of beryllium is also not explained on basis of valence bond theory. According to VBT, carbon must be divalent, boron must be monovalent, and beryllium must be chemically inert. Second thing, that certain bond angles are not explained on basis of VBT. Number one, the bond angle between water, the oxygen-hydrogen bond angle, that should be 90 degree. But in practice, we got this bond angle as 104.28 or 104.5 degree. Whereas ammonia, it should be 90 degree. But we are getting this bond angle as 107. And so, these bond angles are not explained on basis of VBT. So we have to introduce, we don't discard the theory, we have to introduce the concept of hybridization. So let us discuss concept of hybridization with respect to this compound. You are aware name of this compound is methane. Central atom, that is carbon. Carbon is having atomic number 6. So electronic configuration we have to write down. This is 1s2, 2s2, and you are aware it is 2p2. So we have to split up as 2px1, 2py1. Don't forget to write down 2pz0. Hydrogen, now you are aware hydrogen is having 1s1. So let us start the ground state configuration. Ground state means before starting the reaction. Before starting any reaction, whatever the configuration is there, pure atomic configuration, this is called as ground state configuration. So here I am writing only last shell. Why only last shell? Because last shell is taking part in the reaction. So this is 2s, this is 2px, 2py and 2pz. Whatever we have discussed in atomic structure part, their electronic configuration, in that part we have discussed, the things are here now. This is 2s orbital. I have to show these orbitals separately. Whereas, these three orbitals, as we have discussed, they are degenerated orbital. What is the meaning of degenerated orbital? Orbitals having same energy. So technically, electron can move from here to here, here to here, anywhere, because no energy is required for electron to move from here to here. Energy level is same. Like in transportation, we are purchasing our ticket in bus. After that, you can sit anywhere in the bus. That means forget of reservation. But apart from that, you can sit anywhere. Front seat ticket is same, back seat ticket is same. The same thing is here. These orbitals are degenerated. Once electron is here, it can move anywhere. But from here to here, there is energy gap. So electron will not move easily in this orbital. No doubt, energy is required. So here, first electron, this is clockwise spin. Second electron, that is having anti-clockwise spin. So two electrons of 2s orbitals we have discussed. Then to p x, only one electron, and to p y, only one electron. To p z, why we are writing out 2pz0? Actually, 2pz orbital is there. But in that orbital, electron is not there. This is the difference. But we have to mention the orbital. Now, when reaction starts, we have to supply some energy. This energy is called as energy of activation. By absorbing that energy of activation, reaction starts. So what happens exactly? This electron absorbs that energy of activation and get excited to higher level. So this electron from 2s will move to the whatever vacant orbital is there. So 2s electron 1, 2px and 2py, and this electron enters over here. So this is called as excited state. But as we are exciting this 2s electron into 2p, the energy gap between 2s and 2p decreases. They are at now same level, and therefore we are saying this state as hybrid state. Hybrid means mixing here. So s orbital is mixing with p, and we are getting some new orbital. This is called as hybrid shape, hybrid state. Now you are aware what is the meaning of that. All four orbitals are having same energy. Here this energy is comparable. This is not that 1s electron we are exciting into 2p. 2s electron and 2p electron, very minor difference. So these two orbitals are comparable. Whereas here, these four orbitals are having same energy. What is the word used for that? Degenerated. So all now four orbitals are degenerated, having one electron in each of the orbital according to Hund's rule of maximum multiplicity. What valence bond theory says, unpaired electron is able to form bond. Here four unpaired electrons are there. Now carbon can form four bonds. In previous example, carbon can able to form only two bonds because two unpaired electrons are there. But after hybridization, we are having four electrons unpaired, and therefore carbon can form now four bonds. So I have to show the bonding electron in the dotted line arrow. This means what? Electrons from hydrogen. Number of hydrogen atom 4. Everywhere there is electron in S shell. So S electrons are entering over here, and we are getting formation of bond. Now, this is the hybrid state. So this is the mixing of orbital. Of course, whenever mixing is there, we have to carry out recasting also. And so we are mixing out one spherical orbital with three dumbbell shape orbital. So resulting orbitals are having somewhat disturbed shape. P orbitals are having difference, having angle of 90 degree between two, whereas S orbital equally distributed. So mixing result we are able to obtain like this type of structure. This is major lobe, minor lobe. Major lobe, minor lobe. Same way, major lobe, minor lobe. Now try to understand the first this concept. This shape is called as tetrahedral. Tetrahedral means having four heads over here. And now this tetrahedral structure, we have to explain. Just look at my hands, these three. Okay, from this angle you can able to observe, three are there. One is protruding out and two are going back. And one is at top. So this is the top one. And these three, they are here. One, two, three. They are not on the plane. This is three dimensional structure. This one is protruding out, means coming towards you. Whereas these two are going at back direction. And this is in vertical. So anyway, the bond angle between these orbital is fixed. Here to here, bond angle is 108.5. Or in proper 108.29. So 108 degree 29 minutes or 108.5 approximately we can say. The same way here, this bond angle, don't consider this is an acute angle. This is protruding out and this orbital is going back. So bond angle here, that is also same, that is 108.5. So everywhere you are having same angle, the 108.5. This four hydrogen orbitals, there is no requirement of hybridization, so they are having same shape, they are overlapping over here, and this way methane molecule is formed. So central atom is carbon, whereas peripheral four atoms are there, they are of hydrogen. So this is the practically structure. These orbitals are arranging in space in such a way that there should be maximum distance between them and minimum repulsion between them. So this is the possible structure. This structure is called as tetrahedral structure. Now, we can say this way also, carbon. I am giving you this line structure now, or dash structure rather. Here hydrogen are attached and bond angle here is 108. So 108 degree 28 minutes, or simply we can say 108.5 degree. So this is the structure of methane. Now obvious question we can ask, this is the bonding, this is the hybridization structure. In this hybridization structure, what is the role of carbon atom, s orbital, and what is the role of p? So there is one s and three p orbitals are involved. Try to recollect, we have discussed this 1, 2, 3 and 4. So s orbital is 1 and these 3 orbitals are p. So we have to say these 3 orbitals of p and 1 of s. So we have to say this is sp3 hybridization. Why this is called as sp3 hybridization? Because 1 orbital of s and 3 orbitals of p, they are overlapping here. And so we are calling this as sp3 hybridization. Now, in this sp3 hybridization, there is one orbital of s and three orbitals of p. So total four orbitals are there. So now you are aware that this is sp3 hybridization, and in this sp3 hybridization, one orbital is s and three orbitals of p. So we are calling this as sp3 hybridization. In this sp3 hybridization, we are sure that one orbital is s and three orbitals are p. So total there are four orbitals. Out of four, one orbital is s. So out of 100, what is the number of s orbital? We can check out, it is 1 by 4 multiplied by 100, that means 25. So here we can say s character is 25% and p character is 75%. So what is the peculiarity of sp3 hybridization? 25% S character and 75% P character. So this is about hybridization. First structure we have discussed, tetrahedral structure of methane, where structure is not at all distorted. Same to same structure is observed. You can able to observe tetrahedral shape in various way, like in computer also some screensavers are there. In that screensaver you can able to observe this tetrahedral shape very nicely. So I have to revise in short. In case of methane, actually central atom is carbon, it should be divalent according to VBT. But by introducing concept of hybridization, we are making it tetravalent, or we are rather explaining the tetravalency of that carbon. So first thing, that there is mixing and recasting of orbitals. So first important thing, what is hybridization? Hybridization is mixing and recasting of orbitals. Now here we have discussed the structure of methane. We discussed that 1s orbital is mixing with 3p orbital. So hybridization name is sp3 hybridization, whereas structure name is tetrahedral structure. And third important thing, S character is 25%. Now let us discuss another structure. That structure is, now let us discuss structure of ammonia. So again, hydrogen electronic configuration 1s1, nitrogen electronic configuration, atomic number is 7. So electronic configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2px1, 2py1, 2pz1. Now this is the structure of electronic configuration of nitrogen. 3 unpaired electrons are there, which can overlap with 3 orbitals of s. So there is no need of hybridization according to electronic configuration. But with respect to bond angle, we have to go for hybridization. So first part that we are writing out here, ground state electronic configuration. Now you are familiar from previous example that this is 2s orbital and these 3 2px, 2py and 2pz. Degenerated orbitals are there. There is energy gap. Now in excited state, what most we can do, that we have to excite electron, but there is no vacant orbital here in order to excite electron, because all orbitals are complete having one electron. So just show that one electron goes here, but that will make no sense. And then the important state, that is hybrid state, we can have 4 electrons. We can have, sorry, not 4, we can have 3 unpaired electrons and 1 pair. So now I am showing here, because this is degenerated. So there is no meaning that electron pair is here, 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 anywhere. And 3 electrons are unpaired. Now as 1s orbital is there and 3p orbitals are there, this hybridization is called as sp3 hybridization, because these 3 are mixing out, recasting. Now there is question. This pair, we are calling this as lone pair of electron. Again, question is there, how pair can be lone? The answer again same, that pair belong to same atom. Therefore, that is called as lone pair of electron. Whereas here also pairing is there, but this pairing is different, because this pairing is going with hydrogen electron, whereas this is having only nitrogen atom. Now we can make structure here. This is having minor lobe, this is having minor lobe, here one minor lobe and here one. Now obvious question is that here I am placing out lone pair of electron, don't consider ghost. This is meaning that lone pair of electron here. This is one s orbital and this is another s orbital. So these s orbitals are of hydrogen, whereas this is the lone pair of electron. Technically speaking, this can be here, 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 anywhere, because from every angle the same bond angle is there. But now just observe, here one electron is there, here one electron is there. For 2 electrons the space is so much, but here 2 electrons are there and space is so much. What is the problem? That electronic charge density, not the electronic density, electronic charge density is more over this region, whereas it is less over this. As a result, This will exert a repulsive force over all these three orbitals. So what is the result of that? There is repulsion between these orbitals. And as a result, we are getting here repulsion from lone pair. And these three orbitals get distorted back. So this will move slightly over here, this will move slightly over here, and this will come slightly over here. Suppose this is at back side. Suppose this is protruding out, then this will move somewhat inside. So I am showing this way. So this way, there is distortion in the structure. Now you are aware, as there is distortion in the structure, bond angle will not remain same. So this bond angle decreases, and we are getting this bond angle as 107 degree. So this is distorted structure of ammonia. You may say the angle here is going to increase. Yes, obviously this angle is going to increase, but here no element is there. Whenever we are counting bond angle, for that purpose one element, central atom and another element, this way we are calculating. And therefore from any part calculate the bond angle, measure the bond angle, you will get the same bond angle everywhere, that is 107. So this is distorted structure of ammonia. Why there is distortion? The reason is that lone pair of electron is there. So lone pair can repel the bonded pair of electron, because in case of bonded pair of electron, the electron is having more space. So charge density of electron is less, whereas here charge density of electron is more. So this way we are getting distorted structure of ammonia. Why distorted? Because it is distorted from original structure of methane. Methane is giving tetrahedral hybridized structure. This is also tetrahedral, but bond angle is slightly distorted. So we are calling this as distorted structure. I hope you are able to follow the structure of ammonia. Now same way we have to give structure of water. Don't afraid, I am giving here. So water, formula H2O. Now you are quite aware, electronic configuration of hydrogen is 1s1. Now oxygen, atomic number 8. So electronic configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2px2, 2py1, 2pz1. So no need of hybridization with respect to number of unpaired electrons. But in order to explain bond angle, we have to introduce here concept of hybridization. So as per previous state, this is ground state. Write down here 2s, 2px, 2py, 2pz. Two electrons are here, two electrons are here. Now I am not showing excited state, directly we can jump over hybrid state. What is there in hybrid state? One s orbital and three p orbitals are overlapping with each other. So we are getting, in short, sp3 hybridized structure, which is consisting of first lone pair, second lone pair, and two unpaired electron. So electron from hydrogen can overlap over here. Again, as this is sp3 hybridization, the structure is tetrahedral structure. So this is major lobe, minor lobe, major, minor, here one hydrogen is overlapping, here one hydrogen is overlapping. These two are lone pairs of electrons. Now obviously, if one lone pair can distort the structure, then two lone pair can distort the structure still more. So initially bond angle should be 108.28, but now this is distorted, and this lone pair will disturb here, this will disturb here, they will repel each other. As a result, this bond angle get distorted, and we are getting this bond angle as 104 degree and 28 minute, or 104.5 degree. Why there is distortion? Because of two lone pairs of electrons. The structure is still distorted. No doubt, this is not close to 90. This is close to 108.29. That means, no doubt, there is hybridization is there. Otherwise, this may be 92, 93, then we can understand. But there is hybridization, and therefore, we are getting structure which is very close to bond angle. And so, we are having tetrahedral structure, but two apex of this tetrahedron, they are taken by lone pair of electron. No hydrogen overlapping is there. On two side or two arm, there is overlapping of hydrogen. So this is the distorted sp3 hybrid. Now we have discussed about sp3 hybridization and three example. One is undistorted structure and two are distorted structures. Now let us discuss BF3. Whatever question we have discussed previously, we have to now find answer of this previous question. So first we have to now discuss about BF3 molecule. Central atom . So first I am writing electronic configuration of fluorine. You are aware atomic number is 9. So 1s2, 2s2, 2px2, 2py2, 2pz1. So for fluorine there is no question. 2pz electron is unpaired, that is available for bonding. Boron, atomic number 5, electronic configuration 1s2, 2s2, 2px1, 2py0, 2pz0. No doubt that 0 electrons are there, but we have to write down the orbitals. Now ground state configuration of boron, because central atom is boron. So we are writing out ground state electronic configuration of boron. This is 2s. Px, 2py, 2pz. Two electrons of 2s and one electron of 2p. So the question is that this vacant orbital, why we are writing? Answer was there in first part also, and here also we are getting that there is excited state. In this excited state, electron from here get excited over here. Vacant space is there, so electron we can excite here, and three unpaired electrons are produced. Now what is hybridization? Hybridization is mixing and recasting of orbital. So wherever electrons are there, they are going to take part. And so in this part, 1s orbital is there and 2p orbitals are there, whereas this orbital remain unhybridized. So I have to mark here like this. So somewhat degeneracy is lost over here. Here we are getting one orbital of s and two orbitals of p. So this hybridization is called as sp2 hybridization, whereas this is unhybridized 2pz orbital. This is vacant over here. Now this is unhybridized orbital. Instead of unhybridized, another word we can use, that is called as pure. What is the meaning of pure orbital which is not taking part in hybridization? That is called as pure. So here we have sp2 hybridization, one orbital of s and two orbitals of p, whereas one orbital remain unhybridized, that is called as pure orbital. Now just check out here one more fact, that out of 3, 1 is s, therefore out of 100, what is the number of s? So this is 1 by 3 multiplied by 100, so you will get answer as 33.33% recurring. So 33.33% is the answer over here. Now question is there, what is the structure of this molecule? in tetrahedral or say previous diagram, sp3 hybridization, there were four orbitals. Here there are three orbitals which are hybridized. One orbital is not hybridized. So we have to consider only hybridized orbital. So three orbitals are there. We have to keep these three orbitals in the way that there should be maximum distance between them and minimum repulsion between them. Obviously, the structure found, that is the planar structure. Previous structure was three-dimensional, but here we are getting planar structure. What is the angle of circle? 360. Divided by 3, we are getting 120. So, three lobes are arranged according to 120 degree. So, S character is more. S character means spherical character. So, our pure orbital is like this. Now, S character is increased. And so, we have to show this orbital like this. This is the difference. Okay. Now, we can draw the structure. This is first lobe. This is minor lobe. This is another minor lobe and this is another minor lobe of this orbital. So something like our three-bladed fan. The bond angle is here, that is 120 degree. No question of minutes now directly. Now these are overlapping with PZ orbital of fluorine. So I have to show here Z orbital. Remember, whenever we have to show this orbital, there should be somewhat less spherical character because this is unhybridized orbital, whereas this is hybridized with S. And this is minor lobe of fluorine. Same way, this is major lobe, this is minor. So, this is the structure of BF3. That structure we can show like this. Fluorine with bond angle 120 degree. I hope the structure of boron trifluoride BF3 is clear.